एषाम् तन्नप्रियम् इत्युक्तम्। यस्मात् अयम् गृही, सिंस दिस, सो एक्चुअली ऑल द ड्यूटीज आर ओनली फॉर अ गृहस्थ ब्रह्मचारी। एवरीबडी हैज ड्यूटीज ऑल राइट, बट ड्यूटीज ऑफ सपोर्टिंग द एंटायर क्रिएशन जनरली बेसिकली कम्स टू गृहस्थ, बिकॉज गृहस्थ नंबर वन सस्टेन्स द अदर थ्री ऑल्सो। ब्रह्मचारीज, वानप्रस्थ एंड सन्यासी, ऑल ऑफ देम आर ऑल्सो सपोर्टेड बाय गृहस्थ। वेर विल ब्रह्मचारी, वेर दे आर नॉट अर्निंग मेंबर्स ऑफ द सोसाइटी, दे आर नॉट प्रोडक्टिव मेंबर्स ऑफ सोसाइटी इन द कन्वेंशनल सेंस ऑफ प्रोडक्शन। दैट बीइंग द केस, गृहस्थ देन इज ओन हू प्रोटेक्ट्स देम और टेक्स केयर ऑफ देम। देयरफॉर बेसिकली द वन हू हैज the what we call the kartavya or the duty is grihastha. Even though brahmachari also is supposed to lead a certain life and also supposed to observe certain rituals and certain vratas and penances and so forth, and so the vanaprastha and so the sannyasi, but all those vratas are primarily confined to their own self, whereas grihastha is the one who leads the life not only for himself but also for the whole world. So people believe that in the Hindu Dharma there is no consideration for the society. On the other hand, there is consideration of the whole world. Not only society, but the whole world. So we have what we call a built-in social security system. We may not have public places for feeding and stuff like that, but every householder used to be a feeding place. In fact, there used to be, and there may still be, a rule in certain families that the head of the household does not eat food unless there is at least one guest who has been fed. So Swami used to describe that when he was small, you know, he was growing up, he used to find in his own village certain people would go out of their house at the at the intersection and then shout, that now I am going to take my food. Is there someone now who is hungry? Suppose someone does not come along, then you invite them. And then if nobody is still there, then you can eat your food, but at least you go and actually loudly proclaim that now I am going to take my food. Is there someone who is hungry? Is there someone who would like to eat food? At least that is how we invite them. Is nobody there? Okay. But so this is the part of the culture, that the consideration for other members of these societies automatically built it into the life of a grihastha. And that's the reason why social service system or organized methods of service were not there. It is true that Hinduism is not an organized religion. By organization we mean that there is not group organization. There is what we call individual organization. That's the reason why even as far as our children are concerned, the children also were giving the religious training by the parents. They are given the religious training by the parents. So Swami, look, what are we Hindus doing? Look at these Muslims, you know, they have this madrasa and wherever, and so the children go and then always learn about Quran and so forth and so on. And what about us? We don't have. I said, the family, you are the ones, you know, for your children. And every parent's duty it is to impart the same, you know, kula dharmaha sanatanaha. Our dharma is a complicated one, as much as there is what we call a general dharma, and there is a particular dharma that belongs to a particular family in the tradition, and all of this is passed on to the children by the parents. Thus every home used to be a parashala in that sense. Of course there were schools and parashalas, but then all these dharmas also were transmitted by the parents to the children. That's how it was handed down traditionally. So we did not require an organized way of doing the prachar of our dharma. Although there always were discourses and kathas and so forth and so on, which also no other people have. But apart from that, we did not require an organized poor feeding, organized poor serving, organized things, because everybody's home used to be, because there is a joint family. So all the elders are automatically supported. And in joint family, members who are certain disadvantaged people, though may not be up to the mark, they are always supported. Generally speaking, in the olden days, the joint family used to be considered 15, 20, 25 members. There will always be 2-3 fellows, you know, who are not up to the mark, always. A few people would always be there. And so it's okay. What is this fellow doing, you know? Does he earn any money or not? No, he doesn't earn. What does that matter? So he also supported. And that is how, in that whole shelter that was provided, the people who were not up to the mark, there are always people like that. We think that the people in America or people in the West only require mental treatment. We require as much as, or at least as much as they require, you know. We think that we don't have any psychological problems and we don't require psychiatrists. That is because we are not willing to accept problems, that's all. And those people are willing to accept, that's the main difference, regardless of that. What I'm saying is, this kind of abnormalities were always there and they continue to be there. But those abnormalities were always protected and confined to the family, so nobody in the world would know that some problems are going on here. And today also. But anyway, what we are saying is that we have a built-in social security system. When the family unit is now disrupted completely in the Western society, therefore they have to now have what we call organized social security system. That then the government should support them, because children are not willing to support the parents, so government must support them. And parents are not willing to support the children, you know, who are not up to the mark, okay, then somebody else has to do. And so you collect taxes from everybody else and then support, it's all fine. But the reason why we do not find this organized security system is because they were automatically built in the concept of kartavya, in the concept of duty. All of these was automatically taken care of. That when is the duty of a grihastha to feed the hungry, to give shelter to the needy, to even take care of the animals and creatures. And so when all of these are there, naturally, the beggars and all of them were supported. So this Hinduism is pitted against Christianity on this point. How Christianity has always preached, love thy neighbor as you love thyself. And so love the neighbor and therefore serve the neighbor has always been emphasized. And Hinduism always seems to be Atma Jnanam, knowledge of the self, and therefore it is a self-centered religion with no consideration for the society. So it looks like. But that is only when you cross this grihasthashrama, it is true. But a grihastha is not like that. Grihastha, ideally if he lives a life, is automatically a karma yogi. And in his life, that definitely is placed for not only the society but for the whole creation. That sensitivity is there. If people don't do it, when this whole system degenerates, which it will be. Any system is going to degenerate in course of time, which Hinduism had degenerated tremendously. And what all used to be our advantages have become tremendous disadvantages today. That Hinduism is not an organized religion is a great advantage. Because everybody has the freedom to practice the religion the way he or she wants. There was always a freedom of thought. And that's the reason why we have such a amount of richness of thought, at least in those days. So many schools of philosophy were there 2000 years ago. And all of them were actually, all of them prospered. But unfortunately, the subsequent generations in last 2000 years have not shown that kind of greatness which our culture calls for. This culture is meant for great people, for sophisticated people, and not for all these tamas people, you know. Therefore, Hinduism is not adequate to deal with the people that we find today, really. It is designed for people who obtained it that time. I think even those sages may not recognize what kind of situation can obtain. So therefore, it becomes really the role of the leaders who come from time to time to give shape to the system to suit that time and place. And when that is not done, then one's outdated, you know, system, then it becomes nothing but really a shackle for the new generation. And therefore, all those ideas of beauty and all those ideas of joint family and stuff like that, all of those things, when not practiced properly, when the spirit is not understood, all of them only become shackles today. And so it is not that the Hindu religion and the Hindu system does not have all the elements that are required even to deal with the society today. They all have. Except that we require leaders, people We require teachers as well as leaders. We require Brahmanas and Kshatriyas. Brahmanas mean teachers and Kshatriyas mean leaders. Both of them are required to protect the Dharma. Brahmana by learning and teaching and Kshatriya by learning and practicing. So both of them are required, then alone Dharma can be protected. That shows that we did not have Brahmanas and Kshatriyas. Maybe we had Brahmanas, we may not have had Kshatriyas. And vice versa, whatever. And that's the reason why this Dharma has not been protected. Meaning, the Dharma must necessarily respond to the needs of the society at that time. If a Dharma does not respond to that, it will be wiped out. Even Hinduism also, if it does not respond to the present need, nobody is going to bother about it. And there are very few Hindus in India anyway. Just because we are born in a Hindu family does not mean that we are Hindus, because most people have no connection at all with this tradition. And so it is necessary that all that is written in the Upanishad should not be only interpreted in an orthodox manner, and that these are utilized to condemn the present things. That's what happens. That Mahatmas, when they talk, preach, all they do is to condemn everybody. By taking, resorting to this, look, this is what our scriptures say, and this is what you are doing. You are doing all this, you know. So preacher himself is always free from that. You alone are like this. I am above and beyond all of this, you see. This is how the preachers present themselves and create a sense of hopelessness in the people who are listening, in any way that does not enlighten them as to what to do in their life. Regardless of that, the point is that it is so necessary that all of these scriptures must be studied, and the scriptures must be understood in the light of the present situation. As to if the actual advice is not applicable today, the spirit of the advice. If the letter of the advice is not applicable today, the spirit of the advice should be applicable, because this is all based on Sanatana Dharma, meaning it is based on eternal values. We pride ourselves in calling our Dharma Sanatana Dharma, because the Dharma is Sanatana, it will never come to an end, so we believe. But it will never come to an end provided we sustain it. Dharmo Rakshati Rakshitaha. Only when Dharma is protected, that the protected Dharma is able to protect others. So this is all Dharma in terms of spirit. And the spirit is to be followed today in the manner that is applicable today, that's all. So the principles of this Varnashrama Vyavastha, principles of what we call the duty, principles of what we call this Yajna, Pancha Yajna, etc., all the principles can be adopted today without using them to assert ourselves. I should not use the Varnashrama Vyavastha by denouncing others or by proclaiming my superiority. That's not the point. But to understand the spirit of Varnashrama Vyavastha as to how this is a Vyavastha or a system designed to provide scope to everyone to be able to perform those actions for which one is suited, so that it becomes conducive for one's own growth as well as conducive to the growth of the society. And this is how parasparam bhavayantaha shreyah param avapsatha. It's a beautiful scheme of life. Parasparam bhavayantaha. You nourish and nurture the environment around you, and the environment around you in turn becomes conducive to you. We think that all this world is jada or inert. We think that the air and the water, all of these are inert elements, and therefore we can deal with them whichever way we like. That we can pollute the water, we can pollute the air, we can create tremendous noise pollution, we can do all of this, and we think that we can get away with it. All of this is Chaitanya. It is Chaitanya alone which is manifest in the form of the creation, and therefore it will respond. It will respond in its own way. And therefore, we should realize that it is Chaitanya Paramatma who is around us in the form of all these elements. And that when we are abusing them, ultimately we get abused. So, Swami always likes to say, whenever I violate the Dharma, I definitely get violated. So, rub your hand against whatever tree that is, you know. What is that tree? Which gives you all kinds of itching in your palm. Rub your palm against that and you'll be rubbed in turn. Rub anything that is rough, and you are also rubbed. And so rub the Dharma the wrong way, and you are also rubbed in turn. You may not recognize it. This cannot be measured in what we call tangible terms. What happens, what price you have to pay by violating dharma is not something that can be measured in rupees and annas and fives or in tangible terms. That's the reason why we take these things for granted. And as a human race, we have been abusing the environment. We've been abusing the natural resources and we've been abusing one another, thinking that we can get away with it. And we find that we cannot get away with it. That this creation or universe is not inert. It talks back in its own language. It is Chetanam and therefore it responds back. So even the himsa or the violence performed even at the mental level you cannot get away with, let alone getting away with in terms of the actions or in terms of speech. When deliberate himsa is performed, one cannot get away with it. And so the thoughtlessness that we have exhibited because of the total preoccupation with our own welfare, the human being has done that, and that is abused nature everywhere in one degree or the other. And if our followers or whatever, you know, these fellows, see, the posterity will have to pay the price for it. So all we are saying is how the principles of the ecological balance, and not only ecological balance confined to the visible creation, but the ecological balance taking into account even the invisible forces, like the devatas. So that's not superstition. The devatas, meaning that all the elements such as earth and the water and the fire and the air and the space and the sun and the moon, they are all called devatas. You will find in this Upanishad itself a discussion, devatas must always be Chetana. So how can you say that wind is a devata? That shows that it is Chetanam. Then of course the explanation here will be that by the wind devata, vayu devata, we mean the presiding deity of the principle vayu. That means that the principle of wind is presided over by a conscious entity, which is what we call the vayu devatas. In short, all of these are conscious things. And so, they all respond. Therefore, we offer our salutations to them. We offer our oblations to them. Parasparam bhavayantah, recognizing that they have all this role to play in my life. So they are doing upakara to me. They are all the time serving my purpose, and so I am not obliging them by serving the purpose of them. In fact, I am obliging myself by serving their purpose because I am being served. But this is too sophisticated for people of India, you know, who cannot think at this time. People are so dull that this is just too sophisticated. And therefore, this religion really that we have, and we are far from fit for following most of these things, unfortunately. And that's the reason why all these things are in the books, not in our life, because we don't even know what there is in our books, and let alone translating all of this in our life. So this Upanishad and other Upanishads too, and the Smritis and all of them, Bhagavad Gita, all of them are making us aware of a harmony that is called for not merely at the level of visible creation, but also taking into account the invisible forces, which the scientists cannot measure, and therefore they cannot take into account. Therefore Lord Krishna said, Yajñāt bhavati parjanyaḥ. Understand, parjanya, the rain is due to yajna. Although a scientist can tell us that the rains are there because clouds are there and because the various the patterns of pressures and flow etc. are there and so on and so forth. But that is only after the fact. The point is, what is that force that is responsible for creation of these patterns, that the rains only wind up in a certain place and not in another place? Yajñāt bhavati parjanya. If you have to believe this, then yajna, it is the spirit of sacrifice that is responsible for the rain and responsible for the prosperity of the society. If you find that our society is not prosperous, you can blame God, you can blame the British, you can blame the whole world. But we should recognize that we also have some very significant contribution to our present state of affairs, and that we have failed to follow the spirit of yajna.
So this is how the principle of duty, the kartavya, is there. Later on, not being understood, this is merely handed down to the generations, and the new generation not recognizing the value of the duty and not recognizing also the role that the principle of duty has to play in our life, not recognizing this, the duty today has become a burden, which it is a burden. Dharma becomes a burden when we do not recognize the purpose of dharma. Every value becomes a burden when we do not know the value of values. So in truthfulness, non-violence, all the values which are in keeping with the universal harmony, all of them become burden to us when we do not recognize the value of the values. And we cannot recognize because today our values are so gross. All that counts in our life today is artha and kama. The pleasure and comfort, that's all that counts in my life. And that alone is valuable. And that's the reason why these values are not valuable. When there is conflict between these values like ahimsa, satya, and the value of artha and kama, comfort and pleasure, naturally artha kama values win. And therefore, these values are being compromised, the sacrifice. This is what we find here today. And so, it is a wrong value of life. Ultimately, the management comes down to what we call personal management. So, nice point is always made, Swami just says, personal management before personnel management. We should understand the difference. Personnel management is managing the other persons. But before I can manage other persons, personal management is managing my own person. And how do I start managing myself? I start managing myself basically by having a proper perspective of life. What is a perspective of life? What are the basic values in my life? Because my values manage me. So this kama actually is seated right in there. Dehendriya mano buddhi. So this deha, indriya, manaha, buddhi, this is where all the values are there. And sitting there, that fellow dictates me. So I am dictated really by my own values, which values are a product of my own perception of life. How I perceive my life, that is what determines my values, and that is what determines how I respond to various situations. And unless there is a management there, whatever I do, I may be very clever as far as management is concerned, and I am very knowledgeable as far as the psychology is concerned. But when my own psychology is distorted, what am I going to do? And so a person who himself is disorganized, however clever he is, cannot organize others and cannot help others. So start with personal management. And personal management starts with number one, the basic perception of life. What is the basic goal of life? That is, the moksha is the goal of life, then the dharma is goal of life, or artha kama are the goal of life. If artha kama are the goal of life, my own values are totally distorted. And it is those distorted values which alone will manifest themselves in terms of my behavior. And so, does dharma have a place in my own life? And then alone, whatever I do will be motivated by dharma. In that case, then I will have a clarity of mind, and then whatever I may not be very knowledgeable with reference to the principles of management, etc., then I may learn. But if basically my own mind, I have a problem with my own self, all the learning also does not become helpful. Okay, so this is how the dharma, the personal management, you know. But here the problem is that the Brahma Vidya will become an obstacle to all of this naturally. Brahma Vidya becomes, how this, all these cases, yasmat I am is what? Grihi, grihastha. So grihastha is the source of supporting the entire creation. No doubt the brahmachari, the vanaprastha, the sannyasi, all of them also make their own contribution at a different level. At imperceptible level they make their contribution, all right, but the perceptible level, the one who makes the contribution and sustains the creation is this grihastha. This is how we look upon this. Yasmat I am is Gruhi or Grahastaha. Etani karmani kurvanna upakarodi. So while performing these fivefold yajnas, upakarodi, he says, footnote number five, Karma anusthan of footnote number 5, is it? 7 rather. Karma anusthan yogyavasthayam vidyotpatthe asambhavena pratibandha ayogadi bhavaha. Karma anusthan yogyavasthayam. In the avastha of the state, when he is fit still to perform the karma, the Brahma Vidya is not going to arise, and therefore, either one can be qualified to perform karma or one can be qualified to have Brahma Vidya. One cannot be qualified for two simultaneously. That is the general understanding. Jnana yogena sankhyanam, karma yogena yoginam. You can see Lord Krishna's perception of scripture is so clear. You find that everywhere. Jnana yogena sankhyanam, karma yogena yoginam. That both are mumukshus, all right. Karma yogi also is a mumukshu. And of course, jnana yogi is a mumukshu. But while he is a karma yogi, he is still fit to perform the karma. Meaning, as long as he needs the karma in order for inner purification, so long he is not yet fit for devoting himself completely to knowledge. Therefore, there is nothing to worry about. What the answer to this question is, isn't it that Brahma Vidya is an obstacle to the sense of duty that this person has? And when the sense of duty no remains in him, that will he not stop performing his duties? And will it not be that all these different elements of the creation not gain their sustenance? The answer is that will not happen as long as he has a sense of duty. And as long as the sense of duty, so long the Brahma, he is not adhikari for Brahma Vidya, or until the adhikaritvam for Brahma Vidya comes, that sense of duty will be there, and so long he will be a machine, you know, keep on producing. That's what footnote number 7 says, you know. Karma anusthana yogyavasthayam vidyotpatte asambhavena. Karma anusthana yogyata. As long as yogyata or the fitness he possesses is the fitness of performance of karma, vidyotpatte asambhavena. There is an impossibility of vidyotpatti. Because karma anusthana requires a notion of I am so and so. Unless that kartrutva buddhi is there, the karma anusthanam, the performance of karma is not possible. And as long as kartrutva buddhi is given reality, naturally the knowledge that I am akarta cannot take place. That being the case, there is always a contradiction between the two. That's how the jnana karma samuchaya is not possible, and so on and so forth. So, pratibandha ayogat, upakaroti. So, all these questions are raised by Vartikara and answered. Devadibhya. Without reading Vartika, I can say, you know, it must be coming from there. Tasmat, says footnote number 8, Tasmat, sarvadasya devadi upakarakatvad ityardha. See, yasmat and tasmat. So, yasmat means, since he cannot be qualified by Brahma Vidya as long as he is qualified by karma, and therefore, he will remain serving the purpose of the devatas and others. Therefore, tasmat, yathahave loke, svaya lokaya, meaning susmai dehaya, loka word is interpreted here as deha. Svaya lokaya, the fourth case, also susmai dehaya, for one's own body. Arishtim avinasham ichet, how everybody always desires the protection of his body. Svatva bhava aprachurim ichet, svatva bhava. How one would always desire that one's existence must be sustained. Svatva bhava is footnote number 1, mamatva sadbhava sthitim. And that this body should continue to remain as my body. That this body should always remain, because the body is upakaraka. The body serves the purpose of me. And that's the reason why I protect this body. If at any time any part of the body will stop serving the purpose, I will not hesitate to remove it. Even I do not hesitate to remove a part of my body when it stops serving the purpose. Or more than that, when it becomes a nuisance to me, even I am willing to part with a part of my own body. So my own body I protect. That is all right, nothing wrong in it. I mean, this is how it is. What I am always saying, this is how it is. We feel so, you know, we feel so wretched. Is it how we are? But that is exactly how we are. But then, just as one desires to protect the body because the body protects me, the rule is that I protect those who protect me. In the world, this is the rule. Dharma rakshati rakshitaha. Even dharma also protects those who protect dharma.
paraspuram bhavayantaha shreyah paramavapsata ishtan bhogan hyo devaha dastende yajnibhavitaha. Yajnibhavitaha devaha vaha ishtan bhogan dastende. Those devatas who are nurtured and nourished by the performance of your yajna, they in turn will also give you your desire ends in terms of the rains, in terms of the cattle, in terms of the prosperity that you require. So in short, Lord Krishna is saying that in this creation, a basic relationship of give and take is already built in. There is a built-in relationship of give and take, and therefore, no one can get away by merely taking. Sharira yatra vichate na prasiddhet akarmanah. If you drop out, then even sharira yatra vi, if you drop out from the system of give and take and merely remain a taker and not give in return, sharira yatra vichate na prasiddhet akarmanah. For a person with akarma, meaning one who does not contribute in the life, even it is not going to be possible to sustain his body. So yavat jivam agnihotram juhuya. So Veda says to such an extent that as long as a person is alive, so long that person must perform his duty. Because you are breathing, that means that you are taking upakara. And so long you must do whatever you can do. At any stage you should do whatever you can do. And that is the awareness of what we call a mutual interaction that is built in between myself and the rest of the creation. So just as I protect the body because the body protects me, so svatva bhava aprachyuti michet, that's the reason why I always desire that this body should not attain a condition when it is no more mine, meaning it should always remain healthy in a proper condition. Svatvabhava prachyuti bhayat oshana rakshanad vihi sarvadaha paripalayet. How every animal, every living being protects its own body. Oshana rakshanad vihi, by nourishing it, by protecting it, so that it remains its body and it also continues to remain in a healthy condition. In a condition so that it can continue to serve my purpose, that's what we call healthy. Which body is healthy? That which serves my purpose. I want that I should go some place, the body should be able to take me there. I want that I want to see this, body should be able to do that. So whatever I desire the body should do, as long as the body does it, so long it serves my purpose. And I always want the body to be in that condition so that it serves my purpose. Sarvataha paripalaye. How I protect this body from all sides, from mosquitoes, from ants, from pollution, from smoke and from everything else, how I protect it everywhere. This morning as we were driving to the class, naturally there was smoke everywhere. Somebody must have big, burned file must be there. These poor children going to school on their bicycles. I saw them with, the handkerchief on their nose because there is they get suffocated in the smoke. So everybody protects himself. And everybody wants that the existence must continue and a healthy existence or comfortable existence must continue. This is natural. All right, let us see what does the Ayangiri have to say anything here. Purvesham atha shabdanam avipretam artham anudya samantara vakyam avatarya tadarthamah tasmad iti atha means yasmad. So everywhere purvesham atha shabdanam avipretam artham anudya, everywhere there is atha shabda. So it says atha yad juhoti yad yajade tena devanam lokah athayat anubrude tena rushinam athayat pitrubhyo nipranade yad prajamichyante tena pitranam. Yatha means yasmat. Yasmat am etani karmani kurun upakarodi devadibhyah. That is the meaning of word atha. Everywhere. Since by performance of those rites of the duties that he serves the purpose of devatas and others, therefore, tasmat. Tadarthamaha tasmat. Okay, so tena. Tena means tadartha means what? Tena. Generally, so tena manushyanam, no way, that goes with yad. But avatarya tadarthamaha, so tasmat goes with yasmat, and atha means yasmat. Therefore, a word tasmat is provided here. Tasmat iti.
ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮನಿಗೆ ದೇವಾದೀನಾಂ ಕರ್ಮಾಧಿಕಾರಣಿ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವಾದಿ ಪರಿಪಾಲನೆಯೇವ ಪರಿರಕ್ಷಣ ವಿವಕ್ಷಿತ ಪೂರ್ವೋಕ್ತ ಸ್ಮಾರಯತಿ. ದೇವಾದೀನಾಂ ಫುಟ್ ನೋಟ್ ನಂಬರ್ 9 ಕರ್ತರಿ ಷಷ್ಠಿ. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ದೇವಾದೀನಾಂ ಈಸ್ ದ ಸಿಕ್ಸ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಪ್ಲೂರಲ್. ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಎಸ್ ಕರ್ತಾ ಹಿಯರ್. ದೇವಾದೀನಾಂ ಕರ್ಮಾಧಿಕಾರಣಿ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವಾದಿ ಪರಿಪಾಲನೆಯೇವ ದಟ್ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದಿ ಪರಿಪಾಲನ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವಾದಿ ಪರಿಪಾಲನ ಕರ್ಮ ಅಧಿಕಾರಿ ದಿಸ್ ಗೃಹಸ್ಥ ಇಸ್ ಅಧಿಕಾರಿ ಆರ್ ದ ಒನ್ ಕ್ವಾಲಿಫೈಡ್ ಟು ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದಿ ಕರ್ಮ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಪರಿಪಾಲನ ದಟ್ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟ್ ದರ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ದಟ್ಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಡು. ಸೊ ಎಸ್ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಎಸ್ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಸೋ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯ ಸೋ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡ್ಯೂಟಿ ಸೋ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಯು ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದಿ ಕರ್ಮ. ಸೊ ಆಲ್ ದ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಆರ್ ರಿಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಮೇಕ್ ಶೋರ್ ದಟ್ ದಿ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ರಿಮೈನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿಮ್. ಸೊ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವಾದಿ ಪರಿಪಾಲನೆ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಭೌಕ್ತೃತ್ವ ಎಸ್ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಎಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ದಿ ನೋಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಭೌಕ್ತೃತ್ವ ಸೋ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಹಿ ವಿಲ್ ಒಬ್ಲೈಜ್ ಟು ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದ ಡ್ಯೂಟೀಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ದ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಆರ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಬೈ ಪ್ರೊವೈಡಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಇನ್ ನೀಡ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಭೌಕ್ತೃತ್ವ ರಿಮೈನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ರಿಮೈನ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಪರಿಪಾಲನೆಯೇವ ಪರಿರಕ್ಷಣೆ ವಿವಕ್ಷಿತ್ವ ದಿಸ್ ಹೌ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟ್ ಹಿಮ್. ಹೌ ಡು ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಬೈ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಭೌಕ್ತೃತ್ವ ಪೂರ್ವೋಕ್ತ ಸ್ಮಾರ ಇದೆ ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ದಟ್ ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ಮೇ ಬಿ ಸಮ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸಸ್ ಪರ್ಹ್ಯಾಪ್ಸ್ ಬಟ್ ಎನಿವೇ ಯಾ ದಟ್ಸ್ ರೈಟ್. ಸೊ ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ಇಸ್ ಎಲ್ಸ್ವೇರ್. ಸೊ ಲೆಟ್ ಅಸ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸೆಂಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಹಿಯರ್. ಸೊ ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ಯಥಾ ಹವೈ ಲೋಕೆ ಸ್ವಾಯ ಲೋಕಾಯ ಸ್ವಸ್ಮೈ ದೇಹಾಯ ಅರಿಷ್ಟಿಂ ಅವಿನಾಶಂ ಸ್ವತ್ವಭಾವ ಅಪ್ರಚ್ಯುತಿಮಿಚ್ಚೇತ್. ಸೊ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಎಸ್ ಒನ್ ವುಡ್ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಸಸ್ಟೈನ್ ಒನ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಓ ಸಸ್ಟೈನ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಸೋ ದಟ್ ಮೈ ಬಾಡಿ ಶುಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಗೋ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೇರ್ಫೋರ್ ಐ ಸಸ್ಟೈನ್ ಇಟ್ ಬೈ ನರ್ಚರಿಂಗ್ ಇಟ್ ನರಿಶಿಂಗ್ ಇಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ವೇ ಏವಂ ಹಾ ಇನ್ ದ ಮ್ಯಾನರ್ ಸಿಮಿಲರ್ ಟು ದಟ್ ಏವಂ ವಿರೇ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಬೀಂಗ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ದ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಷನ್. ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಏವಂ ವಿದ ಏವಂ ವಿತ್ ಮಿಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಒನ್ ಹೂ ನೋಸ್ ದಟ್ ಒನ್ ಹೂ ಥಿಂಕ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಒನ್ ಹೂ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಟ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ವೇದ ಇಸ್ ಇನ್ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಷನ್ ಏವಂ ವಿದೇ ಸರ್ವಭೂತ ಭೋಗ್ಯೋಹಂ ಅನೇನ ಪ್ರಕಾರೇಣ ಮಯ ಅವಶ್ಯಂ ನೃಣಿವತ್ ಪ್ರತಿಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ಇದಿ ಏವಂ ಆತ್ಮಾನಂ ಪರಿಕಲ್ಪಿತವತೆ. ಸೊ ಒನ್ ಲುಕ್ಸ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಹಿಮ್ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಎಸ್ ಎ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಹೂ ಈಸ್ ಹೂ ಲುಕ್ಸ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಹಿಮ್ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಎಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಸರ್ವಭೂತ ಭೋಗ್ಯೋಹಂ ದಟ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ದಿ ಆಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಂಜಾಯ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಆಲ್ ದಿ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಷನ್ ಅನೇನ ಪ್ರಕಾರೇಣ ಮಯ ಅವಶ್ಯಂ ಋಣಿವತ್ ಪ್ರತಿಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ದಟ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಎ ಡೇಟರ್ ಋಣಿವತ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಎ ಡೇಟರ್. ಸೊ ಒನ್ ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಇನ್ ಡೇಟೆಡ್ ಹೌ ಹೀ ಶುಡ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಪೇ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಇಸ್ ಡೆಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸಿಮಿಲರ್ಲಿ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಇನ್ ಡೇಟೆಡ್ ಟು ಆಲ್ ದಿಸ್ ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೆವರ್ ಐ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ರಿಟರ್ನ್ ದ ಡೆಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟರ್ಮ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೈ ಡ್ಯೂಟಿ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಹಿ ಬಿಲೀವ್. ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಹೌ ಹಿ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಟ್ಸ್. ವಾಟ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಹಿಸ್ ವ್ಯಾಲ್ಯೂ. His value is that I am receiving the favor from all these elements of the creation and therefore I must return the favor by performance of my enjoined duties. And as long as he has this sense, so long devatas are safe. All those elements are safe as long as this person looks upon himself as the one who is obliged. Evam atmanam parikalpitavate. And thus, one looks upon himself in this manner. ಸರ್ವಾಣಿ ಭೂತಾನಿ ದೇವಾದೀನಿ ಯಥೋಕ್ತಾನಿ ಅರಿಷ್ಟಂ ಅರಿಷ್ಟಂ ಅವಿನಾಶಂ ಇಚ್ಛಂತಿ. ಸೊ ಫಾರ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಟು ಎ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಹೂ ಬಿಲೀವ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಹಿಮ್ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಸರ್ವಾಣಿ ಭೂತಾನಿ ಆಲ್ ದ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ದೇವಾದೀನಿ ಬಿಗಿನಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದೇವತಾಸ್. ಸೊ ದೇವತಾಸ್ ಋಷೀಸ್ ಪಿತೃಸ್ ಮನುಷ್ಯ ಅಂಡ್ ಭೂತಾಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದೀಸ್ ಯಥೋಕ್ತಾನಿ ವಿಚ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬೀನ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಮಂತ್ರ ಅರಿಷ್ಟಂ ಅರಿಷ್ಟಂ ಇಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಅವಿನಾಶಂ ಇಚ್ಛಂತಿ. ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದೀಸ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ ದಟ್ ಹೀ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಹೀ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಸಸ್ಟೈನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಹೀ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಸ್. ಸೊ ಅನೇನ ಪ್ರಕಾರಣ ಯಾಗಾದಿನ ಪ್ರತಿಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ಪ್ರತ್ಯುಪಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ. ಓಕೆ ಫುಡ್ ನಂಬರ್ 4 ಅರಿಷ್ಟಂ ಅವಿನಾಶಂ ಅವಿನಾಶಮಿತಿ ತತ್ವಂಚ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮವಿದ್ಯಾಧೀನ ಪಶುತ್ವ ವ್ಯಾವೃತ್ತಿ ರಾಹಿತ್ಯಂ. So how long this person performs a duty? As long as he has a notion that I am bound by duty. And how long does he have the notion that I am duty bound? So as long as he takes himself so and so, as a Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya or Grihastha, whatever. And how long does he look upon himself as such and such? As long as identification with Upadhi. How long does he have the identification? As long as he does not have knowledge of his true nature of his own self. And how long is that? Until he knows himself as Brahma. And therefore, Tattvam cha Brahma Vidya Adhina Pashutva Vyavritti. The Pashutva Vyavritti is Brahma Vidya Adhina. As soon as Brahma Vidya takes place, he no more remains a Pashu because he no more looks upon himself as the one who is obliged anymore. So, Brahma Vidya actually does what? Pashutva Vyavritti. Brahma Vidya actually eliminates or removes that idea of Pashutvam, the notion that I am an animal, that I am obliged. As long as that has not happened, as long as Brahma Vidya has not taken place, so long the Pashutva Vyavritti is not there. And so long this person will continue to perform his duties, and so long the devatas and other elements of nature are secure. And that is what they would want. They would want that he should retain this idea that I am so and so, and thus continue to perform his duties. So avinasham icchanti svatva pratyutyai sarvatah samrakshanti svatva apratyutyai. And so that they can remain there upakaraka, he can remain there upakaraka, for that they will always see, they will do whatever they can do. Kutumbinahiva pashun, just as the householders protect the animals, so the animals remain my animal. That is how it is protected. And so also the devatas and others want that this should be my person, should do actions for me. Footnote number 5, samrakshandiri swadehavat iti sheshaha. Just as a person protects his or her body, so the devatas protect this person, devatas and others. Tatha, footnote number 5 continues, tatha uktam vartike swakarmajita bhoga bhoga swakarmajita sambhoga dāyitvestina kaschana devādinām viśuśatra grihastha svātmadehayoho iti. Svakarmajita sambhoga dāyitve. Devatas are actually dāyitva, means devatas are the ones who actually give the result of what? Svakarmajita sambhoga. So when a person performs the action, devatas actually give the appropriate karma phala. And devatas take care of this person by giving him the result, appropriate result. Just as a person also gives appropriate things to the body. Devadinam vishesha atra gruhastha svatmadeha yohoiti na visheshaha. Gruhastha and svatmadeha. How gruhastha meaning? So just as a person actually protects his body, so also devatas protect this grihastha in a manner similar to a person protecting the body. So I feed the body, I provide the body whatever the body needs, so devatas also provide this grihastha whatever he needs, and that is how the protection is something similar. That is why swayadehaya. So just as one seeks to protect one's body, so also devatas and others seek to protect this person. Svakarmarjitve svasambhoga dayitve cha. Make sure that in him there is the sense of kartrutvam, so he performs the karma. And that bhoktrutvam is there by giving him the result of the karma. Devadishu uvaya prayukta bhoga avisheshaditya. Devatas actually have enjoyed both these aspects, that is performing karma, that there is in him a sense of duty, as well as that he enjoys the results of the action. And that is how he is protected here, that's the idea. Kutumbinaiva pashun tasmat esham tanna priyam iti yuktam. So tasmat, I guess that tasmat must be there. Smarayati. So the Bhashyakara reminds us, tasmat esham tanna priyam iti yuktam. Tasmat esham tanna priyam yadetan manushyaha vidyuhu iti. Therefore the devatas do not like that manushya should seek Brahma Vidya, because then by gaining the Brahma Vidya they will go out of their fold, and therefore they are not happy about it. So it was said, that was keeping in mind all of this, it was said earlier. So footnote number 6, tasmadit devanam manushya pashubhava vyuttanasya apriyatvadityardha. Since the devatas do not like that the manushyas actually should become free from the sense of pashutva, therefore they would like that they remain in the sense of pashu, they remain in the state of pashu.
That means they continue to look upon themselves as those who are obliged to perform actions, and that is how the purpose of devatas and others is served.
Okay, we'll continue tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyapta Dehaya Dakshinamu Ayam va atma sarvesham bhutanam lokah.
Ayam va atma sarvesham bhutanam lokah.
Sayajya hoti yajya jate tena devanam lokah. Asayadanu brute tena rushinam. Asayat pitrubhyo nipranade yat prajam icchade tena pitrinam asayan manushyan vasayate idebhyo shanam dadade tena manushyanam asayat pashubhya strunodakam vindade Tena Pashuna Idasya Gruheshu Svapada Vayam Syapi Pilikabhyo Pajivante Tena Desham Lokah Yathahavai Svaya Lokaya Rishtimachet Evam haivam vide sarvani bhutanya rishtimichyante Tadvaye tadviditam Mimamsitam Yathahavai svaya lokaya arishtimichyed Evam vide sarvani bhutani arishtimichyante So the statement Atho Ayam Va Atma Sarvesham Bhutanam Lokah. How is Atma, the ignorant person, is Lokah, Bhogya. How he becomes Bhogya, the object of enjoyment, Sarvesham Lokanam, all the whole world essentially, consisting of the devatas. Yajjuhoti, yajyajyate, tena devanam Lokah. Thus he becomes an object of enjoyment for the devatas by way of his homa and the yaga. Atho yad anubhrute, tena rishinam. That he repeats the Vedas, that way he becomes the object of enjoyment, meaning he supports the Rishis. Yat pitrubhyo nipranati yat prajamichyate tena pitrunam, that he offers these cakes and water to the pitrus, and then that he makes sure that he has the progeny. That is how he actually favors or repays his debt to the pitrus. Yan manushyan vasayate yat ebhyo shanam dadati tena manushyanam, that he feeds the people and that he gives them shelter, by that he actually becomes helpful to the manushyas. Asayat pashubhyas trunodakam vindade tena pashunam, that he offers fodder and water to the animals, that is how he becomes upakaraka. He serves the purpose of the pashus, the animals. Idasya griheshu svapadaha vayamsi apipilika bhyupajivanti. So many creatures survive in his home by getting little grains of, little grains. And he said, even bhandakshalanadi, because of the washing of the utensils and so forth, all the little creatures that survive, tena tesham lokah, that way he becomes upakaraka, serves the purpose of all these other creatures. Therefore, inasmuch as he becomes upakaraka, he in fact serves the purpose, becomes bhogya, becomes object of enjoyment for essentially the entire world. Yathahavai svaya lokaya arishtimichyed, just as one would desire safety for one's own body,
Evam in the manner similar to that, evam vire sarvani bhutani aristim ichchandi, and similarly all the beings desire the safety for this person, just as one would desire safety for one's own body. Now that is what is being discussed. Page 319, yasmad ayam etani karmani kurun upakaroti devadibhyah. Since this person, karmani kurvan, while performing the karmas, devadibhyah upakaroti, that he serves the purpose of devatas and others. Tasmad yatha havai loke svaya lokaya susmai dehaya aristim avinasham ichchet. So just as in the world one would desire aristim avinasham, svatva bhava apratyurim, meaning not deviating from its own nature, retaining the health, the safety, the well-being of the body. Svatvabhava prachyudibhayat oshana rakshanadimihi. That on account of fear that maybe the body will not be what it is, and I may lose it, I may lose my mamatva bhava from this body. So poshana rakshanadimihi sarvadaha paripalaye. That's where he protects his body in every way. Evam hevam vides saru sarvani bhutani aristimichandi. Similarly also, in a manner similar to that, all these beings of the world desire safety for the continued existence or continued proper existence of this person, so that he should continue to perform his duties. The idea is so that they should continue to gain their sustenance. And that is how they all desire safety. Who is this person? That's important. Sarvabhuta bhogyoham anena prakarena maya avashyam runivat pratikartavyamidi evam atmanam parikalpitavate. The one who looks upon atmanam itself is runi. So runivat pratikartavyam, runivat like a person who is indebted, pratikartavyam, that I must repay my debt. Thus the person looks upon himself as the one who is indebted. That is important. So when I look upon myself as the one who is being favored, therefore who is indebted, therefore naturally that arises in me this desire that I must repay my debt, because nobody wants obligation. Basically, nobody wants to be obliged. So when I feel that I am being obliged, naturally I want to repay the obligation. Well, that's one crude way of saying. Or there is a sense of gratification in me that I realize that I am in fact being served. And so out of gratification also, and that's the idea of duty. Idea of duty is not so much the sense of obligation as a sense of gratification. Sarabhuta bhogyoham anena prakarena maya avashyam runivat pratikartavyam. Sarabhuta bhogyoham, I am the object of enjoyment of all the beings, meaning I am the one who is favored by all these beings of the world, and therefore anena prakarena, by way of performance of my duty, maya avashyam runivat pratikartavyam, like a debtor, like the one who indebted rather, how I must repay my debt to all these persons by way of performance of my duty. Idyam atmanam parikalpitavate. So one who looks upon oneself as the one who is indebted, one need not, but he does, and that is the whole important. The idea is how you look upon yourself, and that is how the idea of duty comes. So always abhimanam. So varanashramadi abhimanaha. So one who is identification with varana and the ashrama, and one therefore who looks upon himself as varani, I belong to certain varana, ashrami belong to certain ashrama, and it is this abhimanam, this notion about oneself is what actually creates then a further, the sense of duty, and then starts a whole chain of action and reaction, whatever. Sarvani bhutani devadini yathoktani aristim avinasham ichchandi. And therefore, devatas and all them, devatas, pitrus, rishis, all of them desire that he should be safe. Svatva prachyutyai sarvada samrakshandi. Kudumbineva pashu. Just as the householder may look after the pashu or the animals, the pet animals of course, not every animal. Similarly also, that's why we always take care of the pets. The animals who are pet, who become the object of pleasure for us, So dogs or whatever they are, those are objects of pleasure for us. So we look after them. Inasmuch as this one is an object, the moment it ceases to be a pet, then the situation may be different. Meaning, of course, then he is acquired a different status. The thing is, as long as he is a pet, so long they always want to protect him.
So, svatsvatva aprachyutyai sarvadha samrakshanti.
They make sure that he continues to serve their purpose.
Svatva aprachyutyai.
So, svatva was said, mamatva sadbhavastirim. That he is ours. And that kind of status should be maintained, svatva aprachyutyai, that he continues to serve our purpose. They want to protect the right. So, in order to protect the right, they protect him. See, this is it. So, svatva aprachyutyai, in order that the rights are not being hampered, therefore, sarvadha samrakshanti, therefore, they also protect him. So, this protection is always mutual. Devan bhavayatanena, te devaha bhavayantuha. Tasmat, that being the case, so Vashyakara said, Anandagiri said, devadinam karmadikarani kartrutvadi paripalanameva paridakshanam. Last line on page 319. Devadinam karmadikarani kartrutvadi paripalanam. So they would desire that he must continue to feel that he is a karta. That's the paripalanam. How they protect him? By always perpetuating in him, or trying to making sure that in him continues the notion that I am a karta. So kartrutvadi paripalanam. That I am a karta, bhokta, so kartrutvam, bhoktrutvam, those kind of notions should continue to be in him. That is how paripalan, that's how the devatas seek to protect him. Iti vivakshatva. So, this is the vivaksha of this passage. That's what Bhashyakara says. Or that's what Anandagiri says about the Bhashyakara's vivaksha. Who says the vivaksha of this passage? That devadinam karmadikarani kartrutvadi paripalanam. For the devatas, karmadikarani, for the one who is qualified for the karma, kartrutvadi paripalanam, that his kartrutvam, the sense of doership, that means identification that he is so and so, or that is a runi, that kind of identification is perpetual, is continued. And that is how they protect him. That's how they make sure that their own rights are protected. To protect their own rights, they protect his sense of doership. So it would be in the interest of the devatas that the sense of kartrutva and bhoktrutva in this person would perpetuate, so that their own rights are protected by way of his performance of his duties. Therefore, tasmat, Subhashyakara said, tasmat eshan tannapriyam yadetan manushyaha vidyuhu. That was said in the 10th passage, so 10th kandika. Therefore, the devatas do not like that these manushyas should gain brahma vidya, and therefore should become free from the pashu bhava. Person looks upon himself as pashu, and that he should cease to look upon himself as pashu is not in the interest of the devatas. Therefore, in order to protect their interest, the devatas also want to make sure that he continues to feel that he is a pashu. So it was said in a figurative sense, how the devatas would bring obstacle on his path, obstacle to his pursuit of knowledge, or obstacle to the taking place of the knowledge, the result of the knowledge, as though the devatas would bring an obstacle. So it was said, but that is just a way of saying, in fact, it's not the devatas are going to bring in obstacles, but then that's a way of saying that you are, in short, fighting against certain established rights, you know. So when Clinton came to his presidency, he proclaimed on day one that in the Senate, that is in their parliament and all these in the Congress, all these vested interests, we have to fight against them, you know. So he wanted to take people into his confidence. So the people should work with their senators and their congressmen. And so that they should become free from this idea of the vested interest, you know, because nothing gets done. It's amazing how everywhere his problem is, not only in India. In fact, in the Western countries, it is done in a very sophisticated way, that's all. In a very, very, you know, very specific ways. So whether they are senators or congressmen of United States, and they themselves are very wealthy and powerful people,
So they always want to become wealthier and more powerful. This human nature is same everywhere, and therefore they can be corrupted. Except that you require perhaps a greater dakshina to corrupt them. I mean, you may have to give them greater temptations in order to corrupt them, as compared to, I don't know what's the standard anywhere, I do not know. But the thing is that anybody can be corrupted, anybody can be bought. And so many lobbies are there. The industrial lobby is there, the commercial lobby is there, the labor lobby is there, the Israeli lobby is there, every lobby is there. These lobbies are, in fact, the lobbyist is an established post. And so people have offices there with men. These people are assigned the task of lobbying. And their job is to make sure that their interests are protected. Any kind of a legislation comes, even before it is in the process of being considered at that time. So all these lobbies know before anybody else, and they start working. So which congressman to go to, which senator to go to, and how to maneuver so that certain legislation does not take place, or a given legislation takes place in a certain way. In short, the decisions that are made are more political. By political we mean not taking into account the real needs, but taking into account the needs of a certain group of people. So this is known. And who is a successful president? The person who can maneuver this process. So this is an established process. And you have to work through this. And you must therefore have a more powerful lobbying with your own congressmen and with senators and so forth. And that is how. So this is a game that is going on. I guess, you know, everybody plays a game and they enjoy it and whatever they do. But Clinton, you know, was really excited about this whole thing, and therefore he proclaimed on the day of his inauguration that we have to fight against this established interest. And how do we fight against them? Because interests are against him, and therefore he can't fight with them. Therefore he must take into confidence those whose interests are sacrificed, and therefore when the interests of the specific people are served, the interests of people at large are sacrificed. So he wanted to make people aware that look, your interests are being sacrificed, and therefore you must fight for this, and you must join me in this fight. And so you must then work with your congressmen and senators and make sure that certain legislation that I think is proper should be passed, and whatever it is, you know. Everybody knows these fellows talk, you know. These fellows are so strong and so powerful, you know, that nothing can work. It's amazing. His attempts right away were frustrated. He could not bring in even the legislation, you know, that everybody thought should be brought, even that was not one. The very first legislation that he tried to push through was, his attempts were frustrated, you know. And so you can see how powerful lobbies are there, you know. President is a very powerful person. But then other powerful forces are there. So this is how the world is going on. So we imagine, in the world also devatas are there, pitrus are there, rishis are there, the bhutas are there. All these powerful forces are there. And this fellow also is there. And he now wants Brahma Vidya, you know. So you can see how much you have to push through. You have to push through all these vested or established interests, because they all want that you should continue to be what you are. And you should continue to serve their interests. Tasmat eshan tanna priyam edetan manushyaha vidyuhu. Therefore, these devatas and others do not like that this person even should seek knowledge. And that's the reason why the Maya is always at work. I mean, you can dramatize things in this way, but that is how in a certain dramatic way the Upanishad says that, or at least in a way making it clear to us that seeking knowledge of Brahman is something that is fraught with a number of obstacles, internal or external, and you have to assign the obstacles to somebody, and so you can assign them to devatas and so forth. What else can you do? So in the Puranas also, Indra and other devatas are always projected or painted as those whose job it is to bring in obstacles to and fight and stuff like that, you know. I mean, what kind of, nobody wants to become devatas like that. But anyway, we project our own fight to devatas also and then present them in that manner. So
This kind of things are there, and therefore, if one encounters obstacles in the pursuit of knowledge, it is understandable. So you might say that there is a built-in system. Now our own nature is such that in fact our own nature will, because everybody likes some kind of a slavery, people like protection, people like. So my own mind likes that protection and slavery. So I feel safe. And seeking knowledge of Brahma means becoming independent. And that means my own vested interests, who are seeking security and protection from some make-believe things anyway, because nobody can give you security and protection. The real protection only can come from the self. But I like to believe that I am protected by this, this and so forth and so on. And so I want to continue that belief, I guess. So it is my own beliefs and they themselves become obstacles. Which we can present them as the obstacles created by devatas and whatever. So now going to page 320. Now going to Anandagiri, the first line. Yathoktam karma kruvan yadyapi devadin pratyapakaroti tathapi na tat kartrutvam avashyakam manabhadi ashankyaha. So yathoktam karma kruvan yadyapi devadin pratyapakaroti. So as described in this particular passage, performing these various actions or duties that this householder does, devadin pratyapakaroti, that means he returns the favor to the devatas. Pratyupakara. Upakara is favor. Pratyupakara, returning the favor. And thus this person, by performing his duties, returns the favor to the devatas and others. So we find, all right, tathab, even then, natat kartrutvam avashyakam. But we don't see why you should do that. If you find this person doing it, is all right. But na tat kartrutvam avashyakam. But performance of this duty is not avashyaka. Is not something that one has to do. Mana abhava. Because there is no pramanam. There is no valid means of knowledge to reveal that this is what you are supposed to do. Where is it? So where is this written? Show me that. So where is this written that this human being or householder is supposed to perform these duties? Iti āśaṅkyaḥ tadvāyati. So says Vāśya, tadvāyatata tadetata yathoktānām karmaṇām ṛṇavata avashyakartavyatvam pañca-mahāyajña-prakarane viditam kartavyataya mimamsitam vicharitam cha avadana prakarane. So tadva etad viditam mimamsitam, that's the last line, you know, that is being explained. Tadva tadvai etad, etad means what? Tad etad. So tad and etad. Tadetat. Tadetat means that this thing, what is it? Yathoktanam karmanam runavat avasya kartavyatvam. This is what is explained. So that explains the expression tadetat. That this thing is known and mimamsitam is analyzed also. Where is it known? And that this is known. What is meant by this? Yathoktanam karmanam runavat avasya kartavyatvam. That all these karmas must be performed definitely, runavat, like one, you know, one pays back one debt. Similarly also, this karmas must be performed in order to return the favor. That thing, pancha maha yajna prakarane viditam. Footnote number 7, smarte. So, in the pancha maha yajna. So, pancha maha yajna prakarane vidi shatapathe, both. Pancha Mahayagna Prakaranam is in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad itself, Shatapatha Brahmana. Also in the Smritis, all of these are being told. Prakarane Viditam Kartavya Viditam. See, says Anandagiri,
భూతయజ్ఞః మనుష్యయజ్ఞః పితృయజ్ఞః దేవయజ్ఞః బ్రహ్మయజ్ఞశ్చైత్యేవం పంచమహాయజ్ఞః. సో దిస్ ఇస్ విదితం, వి నో దిస్ ఫ్రమ్ ద శృతి యాజ్ వెల్ అస్ స్మృతి వెన్ దే ఆర్ డిస్కసింగ్ పంచమహాయజ్ఞస్. ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ భూతయజ్ఞః ఫుట్ నోట్ నెంబర్ 9 భూతబలిః. సో దాట్ ఇస్ హౌ యూ మస్ట్ సెట్ అసైడ్ అ పోర్షన్ ఆఫ్ ద ఫుడ్ ఫార్ దిస్ క్రీచర్. Even today also some old-fashioned people, not old-fashioned but the traditional people, when they eat food, they take out a portion of every little thing from their plate and put it on the side. And we would think that he is wasting food or what is he doing? But that is meant as a portion for the creatures, you know, that is the idea. Bhutavali. Then manushyajnaha. Manushyajna is what? Atithyadihi. So that Atithi Satkara, that you must treat the guests at your home by offering them shelter, offering them food and whatever, that Atithyam, meaning the hospitality that we show. That's the reason why, of course, everywhere hospitality is there. But particularly you find in India the idea of hospitality, treating the guest. In fact, a person feels happy, I guess, in the olden days, that the guests are there. So guests are welcome. That's the Indian style. Not so much in the Western countries, of course, because the lifestyle is different, the weather is different, and so when you are living in a weather that is very cold, you cannot go out, you have to build houses which are all protected and insulated. That's how your life also becomes somewhat protected and insulated. And so there is a lot of value of privacy there. You must have privacy. Whereas in India, it's all warm, you can't live in the houses too long, you know, and therefore people are out. So in all warm countries, people are warmer in that sense. In the cold countries, people are colder. Cold in the sense of always keeping distance and always protecting their privacy. In warm countries, even Italy and Spain, all the people are like, or South America, people are like India, you know. They put their hands around the shoulder and this and that and, you know, even more than Indians. Because in India the touch is not, you know, we have a different notion or complex about touch. Aspruśyada, aspruśyada, and the touch is also considered to be something that can contaminate me, and therefore we avoid it. While the Italians and Spanish people, you know, they all hug and stuff like that, you know, so we don't do that kind of a thing as much as they do. So idea is that when you are living in open, then your relationship are also like that. And you walk into somebody's home and then somebody walks into your home and then you don't bother about it. It's not that you are coming in my way of my privacy and stuff like that. We don't say that. Oh, come, have a seat and so forth. So unannounced visitor is something very common. That's why we call it atithi. Someone who does not announce his tithi or their time of arrival and just comes. So we just take it for granted, we just walk into anybody's home, you know, even today also. And that, without recognizing whether we are welcome or not. Nowadays, in India also people may not be as open as in the past they may have been, because life is different. The values are different. And so we are also slowly becoming more and more self-centered, and therefore the privacy is more valued now than publicity. And so, but this problem of privacy, even two persons staying in one room becomes very difficult in a Western place. Here it's okay, chalta hai. Because they are grown in a small room, six people are growing together, you know. Three brothers and two sisters and parents and this and that. So everybody knows everybody else, you know, and what everybody is doing, everything is known. And that's how we understand that, that's how it is. And whereas there, even if the child is born, just as an infant, it is in a separate room. Not that that is healthy for children, but anyway, parents want privacy, even from their child, I guess, whatever it is. And so, just as when the child grows, a few months, it is placed in its own room. I don't know how they manage it, but this is what they do. So, child also has his own world. Everybody has their own room. So, on the room there is a name, so and so, so and so. So when you enter the room, you know that this must be a small child, and this must be a teenager, and this must be what? Because every room has its own character. So what kind of posters are there and what stuff is there that shows you who must be living there? And so it is their own world, you know, and people don't have much entry there. Therefore, there is a private world. So these kind of things are there in India. These are less. Now slowly they are also coming up here as people become more and more private oriented, their own, you know, as if families are slowly breaking apart and now becoming what we call nuclear families, as they call it, you know, instead of extended family. Extended family, 30 people living in the same place, where is privacy? To the extent that this fellow is just married, he can't even talk to his wife for the whole day and still they were delegated to some corner, some place, you know, I don't know. So how people managed in India, I have no idea. But anyway, they did it and I guess they continue to do. But there is no privacy at all of any kind anyway. But on the other hand, right from the young age, privacy. My thing, you know, my thing. And therefore, there is some corner of my being that is always private. Here, that is, here therefore, Atithya Satka. So Atithyadi, that's Manushya Yajna. And therefore, hospitality or treating the guests is one of the yajna. Yajna means it is one of the kartavya that you have to do. Pitru yajna, shraddhadi, shraddha tarpanam, and whatever you do, pitru yajna, deva yajna is, so vaishvadeva balihi, whatever balis you are offering to the devatas, brahma yajna, swadhyaya adhyanam, so study and repeating the Vedas is brahma. Brahma there means Veda, by the way. So Brahma Yajna means Veda Yajna actually, because Brahma is study of the Vedas there. Idevam Pancha Mahayajna. So this is how we have the five Mahayajnas. In short, the idea is Tadetat Viditam. All of this is known from the scriptures. It is not something that is a figment of somebody's imagination. This is what we find in the scriptures, in the Shruti as well as in the Smriti. This is Anandagiri. Nanu Shrutamapi Vicharam Vina Nanushtayam. Suppose Veda say or the Smriti Grantha says, and still also, just because they say, you cannot necessarily implement it unless you understand the purport of what they are saying. Shrutamapi, Shrutam means what? Shrutya Pratipadimapi. Even though the Shruti might actually say that, Vicharam vina ananushtayam, without vichara, without an inquiry into what exactly the tatparya is, the anushtayam, one cannot really implement that in one's life, practice in one's life. And gives an example, nahi rudra rodanadi shrutam ityeva anushtiyade tatraha. Nahi, footnote number 14, rudra rodanadi, like this arthavada vakya, so arodi, he wept. So fire wept because somebody gave silver in Dakshina. So the fire wept. So suppose you hear that kind of thing, you don't have to do just what Shruti says or whatever you read in the scriptures, you don't necessarily do it in your own life unless you inquire into it and understand what the tatparya is and what exactly it means to you. Rudra Rodanadi Shrutam Itiyeva Na Anushtiyate. Shrutattva Matrena, just because it is found in the scriptures does not mean that it has to be necessarily implemented in your life. That's why some people, you know, they always quote for anything and everything justification, they quote verses, you know. And Swami Vivekananda used to get so excited about this, you know. People used to, because that anything can be justified. Every injustice perpetrated upon anybody else can be justified. You can find some verse someplace. So many Shrutis are there, Smrutis are there, Puranas are there. And so you can find a verse justifying anything. That is how people used to justify untouchability, people used to justify all kinds of injustice done to women and other sections of society. It was all justified. This is what our scriptures say. And he would just boil, and you know. He says, not that if just because you quote a Sanskrit verse, that doesn't become a scripture, you know. So we think that anything in Sanskrit is scripture, and we should think that way also. But then, Shrutamapi na mima na says na anushtayam vicharam vina. So just because there is a verse does not mean that you can literally follow it. You must actually look into what is the context of that verse, in what context the verse is said, and therefore in what context it is applicable to whom, and how it can be applicable to me. Unless we take all of these into account, there is no way that you can simply follow what is written there.
So what is written cannot be blindly followed unless one investigates or inquires into the purport of what is written there. So that is what he says here. Nanu shrutam api vicharam vina na anushtayam. Even though it may be written in the text, still vicharam vina, without the inquiry, na anushtayam, we cannot practice it. Nahi rudra rodanadi shrutam ityeva anushtiyate. So just because somebody wept, you know, at the time of the yajna, so we should also weep, you know, that's not the point there. Tatraha, in answer to this question, Vashyakara said, Shruti also says, Mimamsitam Vicharitam cha Avadana Prakarane. That these Pancha Yajnas are the duties of every householder is not only stated in the scriptures, but is something that has been determined after due deliberation. That due deliberation has been performed on the statements of the scriptures, and after those deliberations it has been arrived at that these five yajnas are indeed the duties of every householder. That's what he said. Avadana Prakarane. Bhashyakara quotes here where all these yajnas are being deliberated upon. Avadana Prakaranam. And that Prakaranam is quoted, some sentence by Anandagiri. Tadetat avadayate yad yajate sayat agnau juhoditi ityadi avadana prakaranam. So it is avadanam. They say that for making one offering, you know, one ahuti. So the dravya, the material like ghee that you may take, which forms one ahuti, so that is called avadanam. That ghee or that which is to be offered, that material is called avadanam. So says here, tadetat avadayate, that this person is said to perform avadanam. Yad yajate, whenever he performs a yaga, he is said to perform avadanam. But when do you say that he performs yaga? Sayat agnau juhoti. So when he makes an offering in the fire, then you say that he is making a yaga. And when he is making the yaga, then you can say that he is doing avadanam. This is avadana prakaranam. Ityadi avadana prakaranam. So in this prakaranam, where this statement is found, we find that all of these statements of Shruti and the Smriti are deliberated upon, and then you arrive at the tatparya that these yajnas are indeed the duties of the householder. Also, ruram hava vayayate jayamano yos ihasti ityadina asvadena iti sheshah. Runam means what? Runavan. So runavan havava jayate jayamanaha ihasti. Yeh jayamanaha asti. Whoever is born, runavava havava jayate. Whoever is born as a runi. That's what the Shruti says. Ityadina arthavadena iti sheshah. And so the idea is that this arthavada is there. So that a person is born runi. So when you are born already a debt, indebted person, then naturally your life must be one of repaying the debt. So by actually calling this person indebted, the Shruti says here, or Shruti implies that these are your duties, that you are expected to do this because you already incurred the debt, and therefore in order to repay the debt, this is what is expected out of you. And therefore, by branding this person as Runavan, meaning a debted, so indebted person, the Shruti is indirectly saying, not directly, indirectly saying that all of these Pancha Yajnas are its duties. So, Runam Havava Jayate Jayamano Yosti Iti, that is called Arthavada. Because there it says that whoever is born indebted. So, what is the tatparya of that vakya? Tatparya vakya is that because you are born with debt, therefore you must perform those actions which are required to pay back this debt. So what are those actions? This pancha yajna, etc. And that is how this statement actually serves the purpose of that vidhi which is done elsewhere, arthavada. And so, vividitam, mimamsitam cha. And therefore, all of this is known to the scriptures as well as deliberated upon. And so,
this Pancha Yajnas are something that are arrived at after deliberation as the duties of every householder. Now we go to the next mantra, and Vashyakara is going to explain the purport of that mantra. I think we should read that mantra first on the beginning from page 322, and then the discussion will become clear. Atma vedam agra asi eka eva so kamayata jaya mesya taprajaya asavittam mesya asa karma kurviya iti etavan vai kamaha naicham schanato bhuyo vinde tasmadapi etarhi ekaki kamayade jaya mesya asaprajaya asavittam mesya अथ कर्म कुर्वीय इति सह यावदपि एतेषां एकैकं न प्राप्नोति अकृष्ण एव तावन् मन्यते तस्योकृष्णता मन एव स्यात्मा वाग्जाया प्राणस्तजा चक्षुर्मानुषं वित्तं चक्षुषाहि तद्विन्दते श्रोत्रं दैवं श्रोत्रेण हि तच्छृणोति आत्मैवास्य कर्म आत्मना हि कर्म करोति स एष पाङ्क्तो यज्ञः पाङ्क्तः पशुः पाङ्क्तः पुरुषः पाङ्क्तमिदं सर्वं यदिदं किञ्च तदिदं सर्वमाप्नोति य एवं वेद आत्मा एव इदमग्रासीत् Ek Haiva, in this Upanishad, these kind of statements are found every time. But everywhere the word, meaning the word Atma is different. So what is meant by Atma? Atma means self. This ignorant fellow here. Which ignorant fellow? Unmarried ignorant person. Not yet married. This fellow was alone. Atma means he alone was. Before all this was born, before the Majaya, before the woman and son and wealth and everything was born, he was all alone. Atma eva idam agrasi. Before the creation of all these other supporting elements, you know, support structure. So before the support structure was created, he was all alone. Eka eva, that's what it means, all alone. So kamayada, naturally, he found himself lonely, and also, he found himself insufficient, lonely, and therefore, so kamayata, he wanted an incomplete, so kamayata, therefore he desired. Jaya me svyat, may I have wife, asa prajayaya, so that I may have progeny. Prajaya means so that I may be born, you know, imagine. May I have wife, so that I may be born. How can you be born? I'll be born as my own son, through my wife. Why then? Asa vittam me svyat, may I have wealth. Atha karma kurviya. Why do you want to have money, wealth? Atha karma kurviya. So that I can perform the action. In short, according to this, wife is required for a person. Then alone he is qualified to perform this karma. Otherwise he is not qualified. Only householder is qualified to perform all these nitya naimitya karma. Of course, brahmacharis also have their own karma and vanaprastha sannyasa. But when it comes to yajna, So when it comes to yajna means this bhuta yajna and deva yajna, all these yajnas. So when it comes to the karma such as yajna, by which you support the entire creation, so yajna, which is the duty of the person, nobody is supposed to perform yajna unless there is wife. And so only a householder is qualified to perform yajna. Brahmachari may perform his own little karmas, but that is for his own self basically. Also vanaprastha and sannyasa. So life of these three fellows, Brahmachari, Vanaprastha and Sannyasi, the life of those people is basically self-centered. Self-centered means their life is for their own self, for their own welfare. Householder is the one whose life is not only self-centered, but also the world-centered. And so he alone is qualified to perform karma by which the world can be supported. That's how the Jagat Chakra, you know, which is in fact supported by the karma, that Jagat Chakra, the whole wheel of creation, can be supported by the householder. This is how it is looked at. Therefore there is a desire, I am not qualified to perform the karma. In order to become qualified to perform the karma, I should have wife. That is why he wants wife. And atha prajaya, that I should have son. And then alone, I will have rest, or I will be secure of the Pitruloka, etc. after my death. Then, even if you have a wife, still you cannot perform karma unless you have the requisite material to perform the karma, the resources to perform the karma. So he says, atha vittam me syat, may I have the vittam, wealth, resources, atha karma kurviya, so that I can perform the karma. When I perform the karma, I can fulfill my desires. Desires for iha mutrada phalabhoga, that I have the enjoyment of the objects in this world as well as in the other world. And this is how naturally this karma is to perform as sakama karma. So karma is prompted by the desires, and I can fulfill my desires only when I can perform the karma. I can perform karma only when I have wealth and only I have wife, and that's why he desired to have wife.